Hey there, it's Board Game Dave. Today I am beyond excited to preview an extremely successful Kickstarter campaign, Endless Winter, Paleoamericans, designed by Stan Kordonsky, developed by Johnny Pack, illustrated by Mihailo Dmitrievsky, aka The Miko, and published by Fantasia Games. This is a game that has raised over $1 million from over 14,000 backers. Did I mention that this was an extremely successful campaign? This is a project that has been on my radar for over a year now, and I am fairly confident that this will become my new all-time favorite game, surpassing games like A Feast for Odin, Great Western Trail, and Scythe when it's delivered, hopefully in March 2022. I backed the game almost exactly 1 year ago, and since then got the amazing opportunity to become very involved in playtesting the game on Tabletop Simulator with a Discord community of over 250 members. I've been able to interact with many of the people behind Fantasia Games, and they are an incredible group of people who are committed to delivering an extraordinary game. Many people online have discussed how Endless Winter combines deck building with worker placement, but it's so much more than that. There's area control, engine building, set collection, resource management, three-dimensional building, so many wonderful mechanisms that blend seamlessly together. With about 20 plays under my belt, I still find the mechanisms fascinating, and there's still so much to explore with this game, particularly with the endless amount of expansion and modular content that's available with this game. In this game, 1 to 4 players take on the role of a North American nomad chief leading their tribe toward greatness by discovering and settling new lands, growing their population, hunting big game, and building everlasting megalithic structures. On each turn, you'll be placing one of your figures onto an action column. Once all players have placed their third figure, you'll move into an eclipse phase before the end of the round. There are just 4 rounds in each game, and after some endgame scoring, the player with the most points wins. Although this isn't meant to be a full rules overview, let me show you the actions you'll be taking in the base game so you get a better idea of how this game works. When you choose an action, you'll work your way down through the action column and take the corresponding actions, including the bonus at the bottom if you're the first one there. The first action is initiate. Here, you can spend tools and labor to acquire new tribespeople into your hand. Labor is spent in this game by either playing cards from your hand with the labor symbol or by spending food. Next, you can spend a food to take another tribesperson into your discard pile and bury a card, which helps you thin your deck of weaker cards and contributes to endgame scoring. Finally, the bonus provides 1 idle track movement, again for endgame scoring, and another bury action. The second action is develop. With this action, you can gain culture cards for every 3 labor you spend. Culture cards can be played at the start of your turn and can provide all sorts of benefits. You can also spend food and tools to gain sacred stones, which become your own personal objectives to be scored every eclipse phase. The bonus here simply provides you with a tool and a food. The migrate action allows you to spend tools to place camps onto the terrain board, use labor to move your camps, then spend 3 food to retrieve 3 adjacent camps and replace them with a village at their intersection. Camps and villages provide influence to the tiles they are on or adjacent to, and the player or players with the most influence on each terrain tile earn that bonus during each eclipse phase. The bonus allows you to place and move another camp. Finally, the hunt action lets you spend labor to reveal new cards into the hunting grounds, spend tools and labor to take animal cards, then tip one of your animal cards to gain the benefits shown on the card. Although tipping your animals can be very lucrative, your untipped animals will be turned into set collection points at the end of the game. The bonus for this action is drawing a random animal card from the deck. You can also choose to rest on your turn instead of choosing one of the 4 action columns. By doing this, you'll get to draw a card, tip an animal, and earn 1.5 labor toward the eclipse phase. So earlier, I mentioned that the eclipse phase happens after everyone has taken their third turn. The amount of labor you assign to the eclipse phase determines the new player order, which takes effect immediately and also dictates the order in which you'll reserve eclipse phase bonuses. The eclipse phase is when you'll do most of your megalith building, which will give you either immediate bonuses or scoring opportunities. You'll also gain any income resources or points during this phase. And that's a general overview of how the game works and the actions you'll be taking. 3 actions per round and 4 rounds total means you're only taking 12 actions over the course of the entire game, but each turn becomes increasingly more robust as you use your culture cards and strategize your way toward becoming chief of the greatest nomadic tribe on the continent. So what do I think about Endless Winter? On my channel, I have 7 criteria I use to judge a game. Let's quickly take a look at how this game does in each category. First up, the art and components. Honestly, I don't know how the art and components could be any better than they already are. Art-wise, the iconography is extremely clear, everything on the game board is easy to read and understand, and the best part of all is the Miko's signature rugged and vicious art style that works perfectly with this rugged and vicious setting. The chief level pledge for this game comes with gorgeous resin components and a beautiful playmat, but even without those those upgrades, the components look spectacular. I should mention that the Shaman and Chief Pledges also come with a digital soundtrack, which, as someone who usually plays thematic music along with the game I'm playing, I really appreciate and am looking forward to. 10 out of 10 for the art and components. Second, the complexity and audience. I think this game is the perfect weight complexity-wise to appeal to both casual gamers as well as fans of strategic, heavy worker placement and Euro-style gamers. It scores a 10 out of 10 here primarily because of how well the game takes the next two aspects of gameplay into consideration. The next two criteria I look for are thematic integration and intuitive mechanics. Thematically, do you actually feel like a Paleolithic chieftain leading your tribe through the harsh wasteland that is the setting for this game? Maybe not entirely, but there are so many ways in which the mechanisms of this game match with the theme. You go hunting with spears and take down a woolly mammoth, which gives you a crazy amount of food. You send out scouting camps to evaluate the surrounding landscapes and eventually settle a village where you benefit from nearby resources. Over time, you bury an older generation of tribesmen and initiate more specialized workers into your tribe. It's all very thematic, and that narrative current allows the mechanisms of this game to flow naturally and intuitively. Two more perfect scores here. My fifth criteria is replayability. Even if I was just looking at the base game, there's so much variable setup with the terrain board, the megalith board, with the chief you'll get, the culture cards that come out. You could play the base game many, many times and not get bored of it. But this game also has, by my count, 9 expansions and modules being released alongside the base game, and with all of the different modular combinations you could come up with, I don't think you could possibly play the game enough times to run out of new ways to play it. I give Endless Winter a 10 out of 10 for replayability. Sixth, I'm looking at the length and fun factor of the game. I believe the box claims this game takes 50 to 90 minutes to play, which could be accurate. All of my plays have averaged a little over 2 hours, but this is most likely because they've been on Tabletop Simulator. It's not too long of a game by any means, and the game never feels like it's dragging on at all. Turns can be fairly quick, and with only 12 turns per player, the game never outstays its welcome. The game is also fun from beginning to end, as you start the game with just a modest hand of mostly nondescript tribespeople, but by the end of the game, you've recruited specialists in each of the 4 actions, developed your tribe's culture and technology, built giant megalithic structures, settled villages and camps across the terrain board, and amassed a menagerie of Ice Age animals ready to score you massive points. A lot of the fun in this game also comes from the player interaction around the table. The game generally starts out friendly enough, but by the end, players are desperately vying for influence on the terrain board, racing up each idle track, and competing for the best scoring spots on the megalith board. The game is an absolute blast to play, and an hour to an hour and a half is the perfect length for its weight. I give Endless Winter another 10 out of 10 here. And finally, the cost versus value quotient. I have never paid so much for a game, but after seeing how good Endless Winter was going to be, I had no qualms about going all in for the chief level pledge. For the more frugal gamer, however, you might be looking to either pre-order the retail version of the base game for around $42, or late pledge to the Kickstarter at the Pathfinder level for about $62. Personally, I'd encourage you to go with the Pathfinder option, since you'll get the Ancestors expansion included, plus the Canine Familiars, Aurora Board, Borealis and Mammoth modules, as well as all unlocked stretch goals. But even if you just go for the base game, I think $42 is a bargain for a game of this caliber, and I think you're totally getting your money's worth with how well designed and well produced this game is. No surprise, I'm giving Endless Winter one more 10 out of 10. And there you have it! All in all, this game easily earns a perfect 10 out of 10 overall, and it's essentially the perfect game for me. Thematically, mechanically, artistically, it is my perfect game, and I have never been more excited to receive a game than I am for Endless Winter Paleoamericans. By this point, I know you're thinking, how do I get a copy of this game? Luckily, Fantasia Games was kind enough to extend late pledges for English copies of the game through the end of November, so it's not too late to order one of the 3 Kickstarter bundles available there. There will be links in the description, of course. Otherwise, you can pre-order Endless Winter through your friendly local game store or your favorite online retailer. If you do check out the Kickstarter page, you'll find all of those expansions and modules I mentioned, and much more, all of which I'll cover in detail in a subsequent video. Honestly, I could probably talk about this game all day, but I should let you go check out the campaign. Let me know in the comments below if you've already backed Endless Winter, and if you appreciated this video, it would mean so much if you would hit the like button and subscribe to the channel, maybe even share this video with a friend who you think might be into this game. In the meantime, have a wonderful week, take care, and happy gaming. Bye.